Hey, it's Joe. I got another question here. This one is from Angela Cambridge from Boston, Massachusetts. She says, how can I make $5,000 per month consistently, reliably, and without risk? Well, there are two ways that you make money in real estate. One is by active investing, and one is by passive investing. If you're a passive investment, if you want to make money through passive investing, you have to have money, because money is what makes you the money. Everything else is active investing. If you have money, then you want to buy some good rental properties that bring you a good income, bring you 8, 10, 12, 15% or more return, depending on whether you set up the deals or whether you buy them from somebody else. I sell properties regularly that'll bring in, you know, 12, 14, 16% return on an investment, a passive investment that we've, a property that we've bought, that we've rehabbed, that we have property managers for, that we have tenants already in, and we've done all the work. You know, I've used my infrastructure. I sell those properties. I take a profit off of those deals, but it still gives a return to the passive investor who's got the money to make it worth their while. And I also know that when I buy those properties, I don't have to worry about whether or not I'm going to be able to sell them. Because if I can't sell them, I just hold on to them and I'll be able to get that return. And my return will be a little bit higher because I paid less for it than somebody that I sell it to. So you can do the same thing when you have cash to invest. But you have to learn how to buy these properties. You have to learn how to build an infrastructure. I had a learning curve. Even after experience buying into a new area, it takes a while to learn that area, to learn what works, to find good property management in those areas. The key to this whole owning property, passive investment thing, is having good property management. And so you have to pay attention that your property manager is paying attention. And you do that by getting regular reports. You look at them once a month or once every 2 weeks, which is what I do. My people spread out the numbers in front of me, and I look and see what's vacant, what the costs have been, what the repairs are, what income came in, you know, what my expenses were. I see what my cash flow is, and I'm able to do that and just touch base once a month with it and not really have to worry about it other than that, because I've got good people who are working on it. It didn't happen like that from the very beginning. It took me a while to get that up and running. But now it's up and running. I don't have to worry about it nearly as much, and it's a pretty nice situation. But you want to make $5,000 a month. So passive investing is one way, but you got to have money to do that. Active investing is the other way, and the way that most people have to do it. If I was just getting started today, I'd have to do the same thing. So to have a $5,000 a month active investment, you can buy properties and put them into a portfolio. Let's say you buy them subject to, and each one of them brings you in, you know, $200 or $300 a month. You're gonna have to buy a lot of properties before you get up to $5,000 a month if you're just counting on that $200 a month passive income from that property. Say it's a $1,200 payment or $1,200 a month income, and you got $1,000 in expenses. That means you got $200 a month in cash flow on that property. So you'd have to do an awful lot of those. You'd have to do five of them just to get $1,000 a month. That means 25 properties. You could have, you know, enough money to be able to get to your goal. And it's not that hard to get 25 properties. Actually, you could probably put together one a month of these subject twos. Now, also you have to worry about vacancies, because when they have vacancies, then you got that $1,000 a month going out. So that can eat up 5 months of profit if you have 1 month of vacancy. And it's likely that you'll have 1 month of vacancy every year. A 10% vacancy rate is not uncommon. You know, and figure vacancy plus repairs. And I've had it where it's been as little as 2 or 3%, and I've had it as where it's high as 20%. And boy, that hurts. You know, when you got 20%, you got mortgages going out. This happened right after the crash back in 2007, 2008, when the market collapsed and people were losing their jobs and they had to move out, and we lost so many tenants. We had a 20% vacancy rate for more than a year, and it was pretty painful. So you got to make sure you have the cash reserves to do that, which fortunately I did. So that made it make sense and it made it work, and we got through it, and now we're back on track again. It didn't take that long to get back on track. So that's one thing. But if you also take these properties and you flip them, you know, you can have a business that flips the properties for you using the for rent method. And I think this is the best way to get up and running. Using the for rent method, it's pretty easy to make, you know, $2,500, $3,500 to $5,000 to $7,500 to maybe $10,000 per deal that you do. So if you do one or two deals a month, you're in good shape. And it's really not that hard to do that many deals because you've got a lot of leads coming in and you can convert those leads. You have to do the work. You have to follow through with the process, or you have to outsource it to somebody who does the work. And you have to pay attention to make sure that they're doing the work, or set into place checks and balances that will make sure that they do the work. What we do is we have a virtual assistant who sends out leads to our telemarketers, and then the telemarketers make the calls, and then they fill out a sheet, and they send it back to the virtual assistant, and the virtual assistant then can see what they did. Now, we don't necessarily tell the telemarketer that we're checking up on them. What we do is say, we want this back in the system so that they can schedule the follow-up, and then they'll send you another note that day that it's supposed to be followed up on, and they'll go back to them and they'll follow up on them again. So that way there's checks and balances within the system without making your employees or the people that are working for you feel like they're being, you know, that we're looking over their shoulder, even though everything that they do is confirmed by somebody else, because if they do this, if they don't do this job, then this person over here can't do their job because they're waiting for this job to be done. So you build your structure and you build your systems in a way so that this person has to do his work, or this person doesn't get his work done. And if that person doesn't do his work, then this person knows about it and they let you know. And then you can go to this person and say, why didn't this work get done? So it makes it possible to put all this stuff together. All right. Hope that helps. It's not that hard to build $5,000 a month income. Most of my mentor students are able to do that if they follow through and if they do the work. Now, I also should put a disclaimer in here. A lot of people that come into my mentor program don't do the work. They don't follow through. They don't do what I tell them to do, or they try to change it or reinvent the wheel. I don't understand why they pay so much money for a program like this and then not follow through with it. But that does happen. So if you're going to get into my mentor program, the first conversation I have with you before you join is I ask you, will you do the work? Will you come on my calls? Will you follow through with this process? Will you do it as I ask? Will you at least put aside at least 8 to 10 hours a week to devote to this process? And this is a week, not a day. 8 to 10 hours a week. If you can devote that, and you can do that while you're doing a full-time job, if you can devote that amount of time to this process and you actually do the work that I tell you to do during that time, then you'll make money. I guarantee it. I've never had anybody that followed through with it the way that I taught that didn't make money before the program was done. I've had lots of people that didn't follow through. So if you're going to get in my program, you got to promise me that you will. You got to promise me that you won't be a whiner or a complainer. And if you do those are pretty much the criteria that I have for getting you into the program. I want somebody who's going to have passion for the work, who's going to enjoy this process, who's not doing it just to make money, but because they're jazzed by the idea of real estate. This is a fun business, and working with people like this is a lot of fun. Getting people into homes, taking properties off of people's shoulders is a lot of fun. And you know, if you do it right, you get people. Jim Durrell used to say, call it the crying quotient. How many people cry at closing, thanking you for either getting them out of a property that they couldn't sell, or getting them into a property that they couldn't have bought without your help, because their credit wasn't in good enough shape to do it. So we get lots of hugs and thank yous in this business because of the way we do our business. We're not there to screw some old lady out of her inheritance from her kids, by ripping her off for all of her equity. We want to do what I believe is an honorable, ethical business. That doesn't mean that we don't sometimes get properties that are under market value, but we make sure that they understand what their options are before they sell. And if one of their options is to do it another way that might make them more money, we'll give them that option. And they still will sell it to us under market value many times, just because the stress of it emotionally is more than their desire to make money. So, you can still do honorable, ethical deals and get great, fantastic, high equity deals out of it. Anyway, talk to you next time.